Good evening, everyone. Before we begin this wonderful evening, let's open in a word of prayer. Father, we thank you so much just for this time. God, we thank you for, once again, just a pause, a break in the middle of the week for us to take a deep breath and just to come before you, to offer you praise and worship that is pleasing and worthy of your name. And God, to spend just a brief moment in your word studying. And so, God, would you be with us tonight? God, for those who are unable to join us physically, and God, those who will be watching this later after this uploaded, God, I just ask that your spirit would continue to move. God, would it continue to move in the present while we're here? And God, may it continue to move for anyone who might stumble across tonight's worship service. God, all in all, we thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Sing, what a friend.
What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. Everyone needs forgiveness. Take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Oh, fill my life again. Give my life to follow. It's everything I believe in. Now I serve.
Father, continue to be with us. God, continue to fill this room with your presence. God, continually ready our minds and our hearts to fixate, God, our attention, our gaze to you. And God, would you use your scripture tonight to speak truth into our lives? God, may we learn something new. God, may we be reminded of something we may have forgotten. But God, all in all, God, would you encourage us, affirm us, and motivate us to continually look to you, the author and the perfecter of our faith. We thank you in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Good evening, church. I hope everyone is well this wonderful Wednesday evening. As always, or as we've been doing for months upon months, we are continuing our journey, our study through the book of Hebrews. And tonight is somewhat of a continuation from last week. And so understanding last week helps put tonight's study into better perspective. Not that if you weren't here or weren't unable to make it last week, not that you will be lost, but you'll still be okay. It'll just be even better if you're able to recall last week's. And so luckily for you, I'll just kind of refresh our memories a little bit about what we talked about last week, right? And so, you know, last week we spent a good chunk of time talking about what faith is, really beyond this elementary, this VBS level type of understanding of faith, right? And so what we tried to do is we tried to dig deeper and go beneath the surface in terms of understanding what faith is and what faith does for us, right? And when it comes to that, our understanding of faith was simply limited to Hebrews chapter 11, verses 1 through 3. We didn't, like, go all around Scripture and try to dissect and understand what faith was. We simply looked at the more than the argument, what was presented to us in that particular piece of text. And it's simply, right, what it said was, faith is the assurance of things hoped for and the conviction of things not seen. And one of the things that we took notice to, right, in the ESV study Bible, it says that faith is a settled confidence that something in the future, we have a slide for this, Deepak. Faith is a settled confidence that something in the future, something that is not yet seen but has been promised by God, will actually come to pass. Because why? Because God will bring it about. Right? That's the hope. That's the conviction that we have. That's what kind of stirs up our faith, right? That kind of what stirs us up to trust God. And you know, but faith is something that, at least for a follower of Christ, like if you consider yourself to be a disciple of Jesus Christ, if you believe to be saved and redeemed by the blood of Christ, then your faith has to be, right? It has to be connected, it has to be intertwined, it has to be attached to hope, right? John Calvin, right, the great John Calvin says that true faith is ever connected with hope. And for us as Christians, what is our hope? Like, what is the thing that we fixate our eyes? Like, what's the thing that we're longing on or we're holding on to? What's the one thing that we're longing for? And that is what? That's Jesus Christ. Our greatest hope is that Jesus Christ not only is who he says he is and accomplished what he accomplished, but that he's going to what? He's coming again. That's our hope. And when it comes to faith, faith is something that will, without a doubt, like if you have faith, if you're fixated and your hope is on Jesus Christ, faith is something that will ultimately produce obedience. Like you'll obey because you have faith in God. And because you have faith in God, you will obey God's command, right? Does it make sense? That's kind of how it works. And that's where all these Old Testament heroes come into play from verses 4 to 40, which we didn't talk about. I suggested that you kind of read and get familiar with some of the things that were said, right? But you see, in the Old Testament, we have these heroes of faith, right? We have all these things that have been accomplished because of the faith and the trust that they had on God. You see, it's because of their faith and the hope they had in the promises of God that it led them to do some ridiculous things. All because of what? All because of faith, right? We are told that by faith, Abraham obeyed God's command when he was called out to leave and to follow him. Right? We also notice that Abraham does well with Isaac because he has faith in God. He trusted God that much that he was willing to take the life of his own son. Very dramatic, very, very, like, ultimate trauma. Like, you're going to need counseling for years if you're Isaac, right? But he had faith. But it was by faith that Moses was hidden by his parents when he was born, right? They did that out of faith because they trusted God. And it's by faith that Moses refused to be called Pharaoh's son. Like, these are the things that are talked about in verses 4 to 40, right? It's by faith that we have the Red Sea parted into two, right? It's by faith that the walls of Jericho were able to fall, even though they were surrounded for 7 days. Right? It's by faith that Rahab didn't perish with those who were disobedient because she showed hospitality to the spies. You see, it's by faith that kingdoms were conquered. It's by faith that justice was enforced. It was by faith that promises were obtained. And it's by faith that the weak were made strong. These are all the things that have transpired throughout the Old Testament, throughout the law, during the time of the law of Moses. You see, it's by faith that people were able to rise up. It was through faith that people gave their lives. And it was by faith that people willingly had their lives taken, right? They were martyred. Right? It's by faith. Right? It's by faith what seemed practically impossible not only became a possibility, but it's through faith that these things that seem impossible become not just a possibility, but a reality. That's the power of faith. Right? Faith has this power, it has this potential to make us do what seems unordinary to the rest of the world. We talked about that last week, right? We said faith is just one of those things out of your obedience to God. When the rest of the world is going left, you know that you have to go right. It's kind of how faith works, right? And we saw last week that faith that saves has one distinguishing quality. Saving faith is a faith that produces obedience. It is a faith that brings about a way of life. And the great late Billy Graham says that. You see, it was because of faith that these people walked, it was because of faith that these people with conviction walked, lived, and in obedience made decisions, not always knowing the outcome, but always trusting God. That's how faith works in our lives. Like, we don't know what's going to happen next, but we know that despite what may happen next, I'm still going to trust God. And that kind of brings us to the acronym that we learned last week for faith, which is F-A-I-T-H. Hopefully I spelled faith right. And that acronym stood for forsaking all, I trust him. You see, so we spent an ample amount of time talking about what is faith? What is faith? And what does faith do for us? Interestingly, right, in verses 39 to 40 of Hebrews 11, we learn of an important detail and light of everything that has transpired because of faith. It says this, I'll read it for you, it's not up there. And all these things, though commended through their faith, did not receive what was promised, since God had provided something better for us, that apart from us, they should not be made perfect. And so their examples of faith is great, right? In other words, like, their faith took them far. It took them further than anything on this earth could have taken them. And it took them as far as they possibly could have gone with their faith. And they were commended for their faith, but did not receive what was promised. Seems kind of interesting, right? Why? Like, why did they not receive what was promised? And that is because what was promised had not come yet. And since what was promised did not come yet, what was promised could not be fulfilled. Because it was not fulfilled, it could not be given. Because what God was providing, what God would eventually provide through the life of Jesus, right, in his life, in his death, and in his resurrection, would be better, right, than what their faith had already accomplished. And apart from it, we would be made and we would not be made perfect. And so with all of that in mind, right, I know it's a lot to take in or a lot to be reminded of. But now, with all of that in mind, that brings us to Hebrews 12, verses 1 to 2, where we will conclude this particular study on faith, hope, and what it does for us. And so, would you join me in standing as we read the Word of God together and listen to what it says? It says, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God." This is the word of God for the people of God. You may be seated. Let us be seated. You know, Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 to 2 is one of my favorite scriptures to preach from. And I think the reason why is because I have such fond memories preaching this particular piece of scripture to youth in my early days of ministry. And obviously, we're not going to be preaching from it tonight. We're going to be studying it, and we're going to be breaking it down and try to tie it all together, because I believe what is said in Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 to 2 is important when aligning it with what was said in Hebrews chapter 11. All right, so with that said, let's look at verse 1. Verse 1 says, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us." You see, therefore is the result of everything that was said previously. It's taking into account what was addressed earlier in Hebrews chapter 11. And that brings us to the "therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses." You know, some things to point out here that I think are worth mentioning. The first thing is surrounded by witnesses. One thing to take note of is that it's not saying that we are surrounded by people who are witnessing or watching what we are doing, right? They are not spectators, right? The people who are looking at us are not fans in the crowd, right? We're not in the Roman Colosseum where people are gathered in massive number watching us duke it away. You see, the Greek word for witness is martyron, right? Martyron. And it carries the meaning of like a witness, like someone who is going to testify about what you're doing, right? Someone who can testify. But when it's used as an analogy, it's referred to as a martyr, and we all know what a martyr is. So when you take that and you combine it with so great a cloud of witnesses, a cloud was used to describe the masses, right? It was used to describe a great number of people. If you wanted to describe that there were so many people present in the Greek and even in Latin literature, cloud was used to express a great multitude of people or things. And so if somebody were to ask you, like, how many people were at Sunday worship last Sunday? And like, yo, there was a cloud of people, right? That's kind of in the context you would use it. Or did you go to Harvest Buffet? Like, yeah, the line was long. There was a cloud of people eating beyond their means. And so when you piece it together, right, this cloud of witnesses is not referring to those, like, spectating, but they are people who have already completed the race, right? Because if we're taking the word martyr, the word that stands for martyr, and we're taking the word cloud, it's the people who that have already completed the race. The people that are gathered are the people who have finished the race. And they're waiting for you and I to finish the same race. And so that means a lot, right? That's significant, right? Especially when you take into account who Hebrews is originally addressed too. Right? When you think about how discouraged they are in their faith, or how weary they have become in terms of following the new faith or becoming a follower of Christ when it goes against the norm of Judaism. You see, the author of Hebrews is trying to show like the people who have run the race, they have run it for the same reason that you and I are doing it. And that's because what? They are at the finish line waiting for us to cross over, because Jesus Christ was the one who cut the rope to the finish line, right? You see, they are referring to the Old Testament's heroes who have gone before them, right? Who are the very examples of faith that they were raised on. You know, from early childhood, right? They have been taught that who's great? Moses. Like, who is like the father of faith? It is Abraham. Like, why do we do the things that we do? Because Moses received the law from God. Like, why do we do the things, right? Because King David did this, right? Solomon did that. Like, Solomon was so wise. We do all these things, right? These are the heroes, right? These are the people that they looked up to. And in my opinion, for them as a people from a Jewish upbringing, right, culturally and religiously, the Old Testament heroes to them are the standard of faith and what obedience looks like, right, to follow God. And the author of Hebrews is saying, like, those are the people who are waiting at the finish line. Those are the people who are surrounded, right, cheering you on, urging you, pleading with you to finish this race. And so since we are surrounded by those guys, by those people, then what does that mean to us? You see, the thing that is being urged to us, right, as we complete the race, as we run this race with endurance, the author of Hebrews tells us to do what? To do two things, to get rid of what? Weight and sin, right? It's no secret that when you're running a race, right, whether it's against a friend who keeps talking trash, saying that they're faster than you, like if you've ever been in that situation, the first thing that you do is you empty your pockets, right? You don't run with a football. You empty your pockets. You take off. You're taking off your sweater. You're doing whatever you can to reduce your weight, right? If you're an Olympic runner, you're not running in a North Face jacket and boots. Right? You're running in the minimal amount of clothing, right? If you're a marathon runner, you've been training for this. But everything that these runners have in common is that you're not going to carry on you more weight than what is necessary. Right? If anything, less weight is better. We all know that's no secret, right? But in this scenario, right, in this scenario of faith and living the Christian life, what might be something that weighs us down? Like, what could this author be alluding to when he's speaking into the lives of the Jewish Christians and to us? Could the extra weight, could it be doubt? Possibly. Could it be fear? You know, I think fear has a tendency to slow us down in our race, in this journey of faith. Maybe it's logic. Because logically, like, what God is asking of you just doesn't make sense. It's a possibility. Maybe it's societal standards. Like, it goes against what the rest of the world is going. Maybe it's cultural standards. It's possible. Maybe it's discouragement. Like, you just don't want to run anymore. Or you feel like running has gotten you nowhere. It's possible, right? It could be the pressures, like peer pressures. It could be career pressures, like work, the demand that work is putting on you. And if you're a Jewish Christian going in this time, being a follower of this new faith and all the drama that it's possibly causing in your life, then maybe you have this fear of persecution or excommunication, right, from your family, from your tribe. And that weight can weigh heavily on you. But here's the thing about added weight. It places limitations on you. It limits what you are able to do. It limits what you are able to accomplish. It limits how far you're able to progress in terms of your life, your faith, and your ability to trust God. You know, when I watch UFC, MMA, on, I don't know if you guys like that kind of stuff, but whenever I watch UFC and it's the heavyweights that are fighting, the heavyweights are the people who are, I believe, like they're 220 pounds or heavier, right? And I think the maximum you can be is like 280. I don't quote me on it, right? But the announcers always commentate on the fighters, right, about their weight. And the reason why they do so is because when they say, like, when you have that much weight on you, just kind of just their full weight, body weight on you, you know what that does to you as a fighter? It's not comfortable. But what it does is these heavy dudes with their massive weight compressed against you will eventually wear you down
tear you down and ultimately break you. Like, they don't even have to, like, hit you. Their mere weight alone over your body makes it difficult for you to breathe. And just in order to breathe normally, you're going to expound a tremendous amount of energy. And for me, when I think about that, I know it's a weird image to have, but when I think about that, you see, added weight is unnecessary and hinders us from running the race, right? It hinders us from running to our potential. It wears us down. It discourages us. And I think it probably sucks all the motivation out of us. And the author of Hebrews makes it seem as if this weight is something that we can do without. I think this added weight that we keep, quite possibly self-inflicted. This is the weight that we want to keep. This is the weight that I have a hard time letting go of. This is the weight that I would rather just burden myself with and keep moving forward. So it sounds like how guys like to operate, right? We just kind of just carry on as much more than we can, and we just keep moving forward. But the author of Hebrews is pleading, where he's telling us that this is weight that you can do without. And if that's the case, let us go without. And so maybe a question we can ask is, like, what is this added weight that I'm carrying in my life? And how does that hinder the way that I not only live my life for the gospel, but how tired is it making me? It's no mistake that the author of Hebrews puts together, let us lay aside the weight, and then follows up with, let's run this race with endurance. Because what that means is that this isn't the short game. We're planning for the long game. We're playing the long haul. And so what are some of the things that we could go without? And that kind of brings us up to the next thing that adds weight onto our lives, and it may not be weight upon our shoulders, it could be weight upon our hearts. And that is what? That is sin. And he says what? To get rid of that too. And I couldn't agree more. Right? You see, the thing about sin and the way that it weighs down in our lives, the way that it kind of slows us down, the way that it kind of makes us not operate to our full capacity, is that continued sin in our lives, right? Continued sin or lingering sin or sin that has been left without repentance has the potential, right? Hear me out, has the potential to undo the progress we've made moving forward. If anything, it has the potential to set us back. If anything, it has the potential to bring us back. If anything, it has the potential to stop us in our tracks, and it has the potential to make us want to quit this race, right? This race of faith, this race of living and following after Jesus, right? Sin that is left unresolved, the sin that we have a tendency to ignore, has the potential to make us want to quit and leave in the middle of this race. Unfortunately, sin has the potential to suck the life out of our hope. Sin has the potential and even has a tendency to suck us dry and to leave us for dead. And I know I've kind of all of a sudden painted a dark picture. But here's the thing. That's where Jesus comes in. That's what makes Jesus so vital. It's what makes Jesus so important. Because if we are going to run this race with endurance, we're going to need to be able to fixate our eyes upon something. We're going to have to be able to envision something ahead of us, even though we may not be able to see it just yet. And when you run a race, and I've never run a marathon, and I probably never, ever will, but if I imagine that if I were to run a marathon, that in my head, that I would be imagining, I'd be focused on the finish line. And for us, the way that we do so is by fixating our eyes on Jesus. Because if we're going to run this race with endurance, we need hope. We need something to look forward to. And we need something that is trustworthy, that is worthwhile, that is proven. Right? And that's why in verse 2 it says, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. So what is our hope? Or how do we fixate our hope? How do we run this race with endurance? Like if I'm a Jewish Christian and I am discouraged, if I'm ready to call it quits, if I'm a seasoned Christian and this season has been tough, I've just been disappointed too many times, I'm weary, I'm tired, but how can I run with endurance? The answer is simple, yet it's so tough. Look to Jesus. But why do we look to Jesus? Like we know that's the answer. We know that that's the remedy. But what makes that so vital? What makes that so necessary? What makes that so important? We look to Jesus because he completed the race. And not only did he complete the race, he did so as the founder of faith. And he completed the race, becoming the perfecter of our faith. We look to Jesus because he's our example, right? He not only took the cross, but he endured the path that led him to the cross and remained sinless. Like, Jesus is our ultimate example. Like, he faced temptation, right? He was pitted against me. He was, like, betrayed. He was put in so many different scenarios where you and I probably would have failed on the first try. But he did not. Jesus finished the race. He completed the race without succumbing to anything that had the potential to bring him down. And so we look to Jesus because he is our ultimate example. He is the perfect example. We also look to Jesus because he is our hope. But Jesus isn't a dead hope. Like, he's not a historical hope. He's not an Old Testament hero kind of hope. For us, Jesus is our living hope because we know that Jesus is not dead, but that he is alive. And because he is alive, that he will what? He will come again. Right? Jesus is our living hope. In 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3, it says, he caused us to be born again to a living hope. Right, through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. You see, we look to Jesus because he did it. We look to Jesus because he accomplished it. We look to Jesus and we see that it's possible. We look to Jesus because we see that with faith and hope, what is able to happen, what is able to unfold in our lives. We look to Jesus because we see that he finished the race. And because he finished the race all the way, that the Old Testament heroes followed in after him. And that they are at the finish line waiting for you and I to not only finish this race, but they want us to finish this race. I'll close with this example. I don't know how many of you in here like running. I don't. I'm not really a fan. I can play basketball for hours upon hours, but ask me to run a mile, and I will dread it. But apparently, up until May 5th, 1954, no one could get their mile time underneath the four-minute mark. I remember high school, I could barely break 6 minutes. I don't know, like, high fives, I mean, if I'm lucky, right? But for the longest time, everyone tried to make their mile time under the four-minute mark, and they just couldn't do it. And people were, like, literally, like, they're like, it's impossible. It's impossible to run the mile in under 4 minutes. There's no hope. Like, they were like, man, it's impossible. Then on May 6, 1954, a man by the name of Roger Bannister broke the 4 minute mile. Right? His time was 3 minutes, 59 seconds, and some tenths of a second. I think it's 0.4, right? But he did it. He broke the 4 minute mile. But he just barely did it. But do you know what that did for runners all around the world? It gave them hope. They're like, oh, shoot. Somebody broke the 4 minute mile. You know what they probably said to themselves? It's possible. And because it's possible, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to train a little harder. You know what? Because it's possible, I'm going to run a little faster. Because it's possible, I'm going to push myself just a little more. I know it's hard, I know it's tough, and I know it seems impossible. It doesn't seem worthwhile, but because Roger Bannister was able to break the 4 minute mile, I think I might be able to do so as well. And according to historical records, in less than 1 year, another individual was able to not only break the 4 minute mile, but he was able to run it faster than Roger Bannister. All because one individual was able to do something that was deemed impossible by everyone else who had tried before them. But because one individual was able to do it, it sparked this great hope in the lives of others, right, that this was a obtainable possibility. To this day, the fastest mile time is 3 minutes and 43 seconds. And getting a mile time under 4 minutes has become the standard. Like even high school kids are able to run the mile in under 4 minutes. But up until 1954, right, May 5th, 1954, it was something that was deemed impossible. But all of a sudden, because one individual was able to do it, to the rest of the world, what was impossible had to become a possibility. You see, that's what Jesus does for us. Right? In our hopelessness, what seems like a hopeless situation, because we fixate our eyes on Jesus, because we know that Jesus is not only the author, but the perfecter of our faith, we know that it's possible. Not because of who we are, but because of everything that Jesus is. That's what faith does for us. That's what a faith-filled hope does for us. What might seem impossible, we look to Jesus and we know that it's possible. We look at our situation and it might seem like the most difficult situation ever known to man. And then we look at Jesus and we remember that he took the cross, he bore our shame. That our situation isn't as bad. And because we have hope, we're able to continue to move forward. You see, because Jesus was able to accomplish all that he was able to for our sake, knowing that truth and trusting and having that hope, like that's something that should supercharge our faith to be filled with hope. Our faith is the assurance of things not yet seen. Right? And it's the conviction of the hope that we have. And that hope, at least for me, and I hope it is for you, that hope is Jesus Christ. And so when it comes to our lives, when it comes to our faith, looking to Jesus helps us keep running when we can't run. Right, looking to Jesus helps us keep going when I don't want to go any further. Looking to Jesus motivates me, encourages me to take one step further than I did yesterday, because I know that he and the rest of everyone else is waiting for me at that finish line. It's not about who can finish the race the fastest. It's about who will endure to see the finish line when this life is said and done. We do so because of the faith that we have. We do so because of the hope that we have. And we can continue to do so no matter what we are going through. When we are fixating our eyes, our hearts, our attention, and our motivation to Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone, because He, like we've already said, He is the author, the founder, and the perfecter of our faith. And so if you are discouraged, if you are just kind of complacent with where you are, if you're okay with where you've been for the past year or 2 years or 6 years or whatever, my plea for you is that you would look to Jesus, that you would be reminded of the race that your life has been called to run. And it's not about how fast or how far you can get, the quickest. But it's about those who will continually participate in this race with endurance, because they know the prize that awaits them at the finish line. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for tonight. God, we thank you for this time. And Father, I pray that we would be reminded, that we would be encouraged, and that, God, we would be motivated to continue to run this race. God, we are able to run this race because you are our living hope. God, we are able to run this race because you are the founder and the perfecter of faith. God, we are able to run this race because, God, you have already created that path. And God, all we need to do is follow. God, we thank you that you were able to be the very thing that God promised, the fulfillment of God's promise. God, we thank you that you crossed that finish line and that you have prepared a way for us. And so, God, may tonight, may we be encouraged. God, may we be reminded and may we be motivated. God, I pray for anyone in this room who might have lingering sin, who has unrepentant sin in their lives. God, I pray that you would stir up within them a conviction. And God, in that conviction, that they would come before you and they would confess from not only their mouths, but their hearts. And God, I pray that in that moment that you would, first and foremost, that you would forgive them. That God, you would shower them with your grace. And God, that you would purify them of that very sin that existed in their lives. God, I pray that you would lead us into repentance. And as you lead us into repentance, that God, you would be leading us into reconciliation and restoration as well. And now we ask that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and that the love of the God, the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of us until we meet in your house once again. We ask all these things in Jesus' most holy and precious name. Amen.